Okay, the next lecture will be on signal processing. Some initial part I will cover, and then Senthil Kumar will cover the more detailed version of data processing and analysis for hot wire. So any, let's say the hot wire probe is there, and that gives you data. The amount of data that you acquire is so large, obviously it has to be recorded. So we will record it in a computer, and then after it is recorded in the computer, you will analyze the data for various properties like mean or RMS or autocorrelation, cross correlation, or spectral components of what is there in the turbulence data, etc. All those come as data processing. And so, but before we do that, we need to understand certain things. Typically, any probe, right? The probe, the signal that comes from that will be analog signal. Whereas, what is required by the computer will be digital. So, the computer itself is a digital device. What is the difference between analog and digital, and why should, nowadays almost everything is digital, right? So, why do we go for digital signal processing? What is the advantage? The analog signals are more susceptible to noise. Right? For example, there is a wire which is carrying the signal. Nearby there is a magnet or some instrument which has a strong electric field. So if the wire is going near that, that electrical field will affect this. So whatever the signal on that, some noise will sit over that, and finally what you get will have that noise. Digital, the advantage is that, what is meant by digital? Digital is simply made up of 0, 1. Either it is there or not there, alright? So in that, whether 1 or 0.99 or 1.1 doesn't matter. Either one is 1 only. Signal being there is 1 and not being there is 0. So it is therefore free from all this electromagnetic noise. It is also susceptible to some extent, but a much smaller extent than what will be there for the analog signal. So nowadays, therefore, everything is preferred only in terms of digital data. So even what is naturally coming in analog form, we convert to digital form. So if there is a thermocouple which is giving you some data, temperature as a function of time, something. So this analog data, you have to convert that into digital form. So essentially, at some uniform intervals, so the whole data therefore will get chopped into slices like this, and those are the ones which are transferred to the computer. That's the A to D conversion. So analog to digital conversion is one thing. I also added one more thing, signal conditioning. So often you may have to condition the signal also. Conditioning signal means any modification that you introduce will be called signal conditioning. One of the simplest thing that is done is amplification. All right? Because for example, the signal, suppose let's say this is a thermocouple. Thermocouple, does anybody know what is the type of signal you'll get from a thermocouple? What is the order of the signal? Millivolts. Thermocouple will give you in millivolts. Right? So voltage signal coming in the, all of the order of millivolts. But the computer, it operates in a 0 to 10 or minus 5 to plus 5 volts range. So the signal has to be converted to 0 to 10 volts or minus 5 volts to 10 volts, 5 volts. Over a range of 10 volts. So millivolts is too small. So you have to bring it up to this. That means you have to amplify the signal. So the thermocouple is giving, let's say, some 3 millivolts or some such thing. This is too small. So amplify by a factor of 100 or 1000 or something. Then it will become of the order of volts. Then it is suitable for recording in the computer. So amplification is one thing. There are many other things which may be necessary as well. Of course, sometimes you can do some filtering. Digital filtering can be done. Low frequency noise can be eliminated. High frequency noise can be eliminated, etc. There are filters, high pass filter, low pass filters can be to remove what is data which is not in your range of interest. As far as your problem is concerned, that is noise. Don't want to keep it. So that can be removed. So all of these will come under signal conditioning. So any data, whether it is temperature data, hot wire data, or whatever, eventually before going to the computer, you have may have to convert that from analog to digital conversion may be required. Then conditioning of the signal to amplifier etc. may be required. So after all that is done, then you store it in the computer. And while doing that, some things that we need to look at, the selection of this A to D cards, analog to digital cards, what kind of, please remember that everything in the entire circuit must have adequate resolution, adequate frequency response and so on. Alright? If something like in a road, you have laid out a fantastic road and where a car can travel at 150 kilometers per hour, but there is a bullock cart in between that travels at 5 kilometers per hour, everybody will be affected by it. So you have to have in a chain of data collection, everything must have the same type of, or at least some common or better than that one. Okay, so if about hardware we were saying that 100 kilohertz kind of response is necessary, then the A to D card also must have, analog to digital card also must have the same kind of capability, and so on. And so normally when you buy an A to D card from the market, they will say 1 megahertz clock etc. So you can look at, okay, the clock is of that frequency, then it can find events which are like 100 kilohertz etc. In all these cards, clock tells you the speed with which it can, even computer for example, they will say the board has so many megahertz clock etc. 1 gigahertz clock, like that will be there. So that gives you an idea of, because the digital signal, by the way, it is digitized in two respects, with respect to time, only at certain instants of time the event is recorded, in between as if time doesn't exist, alright, either this or this, or this, like, okay. So time goes in discrete steps. Even the values, by the way, they are all discretized, alright. How does it get discretized? It depends upon the card that is being used, how many bits are there. They will say 8 bit card, 12 bit card, 16 bit card etc. Right? So bit means, suppose for example something is 16 bit. So 16 bit means 2 to the power 16, or let me say 8 bit, 2 power 8 is 256. So it's as if it divides the total range, for example let's do 10 volts, 0 to 10 volts is the maximum, so the 10 gets divided into 256 parts. So it can only record in integral multiples of that the least count, right. So your signal can be recorded as 1 by 256, where the difference can be, the least count will be 1 by 256 of the maximum 10 volts. So the higher the number of bits, that means smaller is your least count. Alright, the same 10 volts, you can divide it into more number of parts. So 16 bit means 256 into 256. So the least count will be 10 volts divided by 256 into 256. That will be a very small kind of. So the higher the number of bits of the A to D card, the more will be the resolution that you will get in recording the signal. So these are some of the things that we need to know about the frequency response of the card itself and so on. And what is the environment of a computer? In the computer, everything is digitized, time goes in discrete steps, all voltage values go in discrete values, like we talk about quantum physics etc. Energy is quantized, means only in certain quanta it can happen. Here the voltage signals are all in quantums only, they can increase. Time can also go in only in discrete steps, alright. But in terms, anything, any value has to be approximated to the lowest, remember the closest discrete value that is available. Okay, next. Yeah, so you see here various things here, the probe 1, probe 2 etc. In the context of our hardware, there is a bridge as we saw, the constant anemometer temperature, CTA bridge, constant temperature anemometer bridge, which has all those 4 resistances, feedback loop etc. All those things are there. So the bridge is there with a loop. Then signal conditioner 1, the signal conditioner itself can be the A to D card. So it can do amplifying, it can do filtering etc. Alright. and then after the signal is conditioned, it goes to a multiplexer. What is a multiplexer? See, for example, again, you may have, for example, many instruments, many probes, all right? Connecting them simultaneously to the computer may be difficult. So then what happens is, suppose you have thousands of thermocouples, all right? The multiplexer will select one of them, take that data, and then go to the next one, then go to the next one, etc. So multiplexing is the one by with the help of which you can use several probes here, can use the rest of the things as a common, right? It is something like, you know, a boss is sitting, boss cannot meet 1,000 people at the same time, so one by one they will be admitted, right? So the expensive part of your data acquisition, maybe the A2D card is very expensive, several lakhs it may cost, PC may be also expensive. So there are 1,000 thermocouples, data from each of the thermocouples will be multiplexed. The multiplex is basically a way of selecting one of them. Of course, it will be done at a very high rate, fast rate. That is not a problem. So 1, then 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then one by one, the data will get admitted. That will get amplified, etc., conditioned, then go to the computer. Then next one, and like that. So several of them can be done one after another. So multiplexing is an operation by which, even if you have pressure transducers, several pressure transducers, one at a time can use the rest of the expensive portion of data acquisition can be channeled through the multiplexer. Then this S and H, which is shown there, by the way, I mean, many times this amplifying, etc., can even be done here. There is no hard and fast rule that there must be signal conditioning here and not here. Signal conditioning can happen anytime, anywhere. It can be part of the bridge itself. Bridge itself can do some signal conditioning, that is possible. A2D card can do that. So this is just going showing only a schematic, seeing what are all the different things which are being done. So a probe with the help of bridge and loop, etc., you get to generate the voltage signals. If you want, you can condition that voltage signal here itself and then go to the multiplexer, then finally go through the A2D conversion. Or I mean, many things, even here itself can be converted to A2D, all possibilities are there. Anyway, this sample and hold is only, in fact, it's actually part of this. What it means is that, how does it actually do the digitizing? It will, actually this sample and hold can even come before the multiplexer, that's also possible, that can be here also. Sample and hold means it takes a particular sample, it will hold it in memory until that is processed and sent. Then next sample will be held there until it's processed, it will be held, and so on. So it will take a particular sample and hold it there until the processing is done for that one. There are, for example, as I told you, it is also possible that a probe is there, bridge does the voltage signal generation, the voltage is conditioned, etc. Then it is held in, sample and hold is there, then it goes to the multiplexer. Multiplexer will select any one of them, and then A2D conversion. So there is no hard and fast rule about where it should come, but somewhere the operations should be there so that they are handled in general. A2D conversion will basically chop the analog signal into digital part, and then finally it is communicated to the computer. And all these events are, you know, precisely done. By the way, this is done for simultaneous, for example, U and V. See, in the previous configuration, for example, if this is U velocity goes, it is just held in the sample, then A2D conversion, then goes. Then V velocity comes, it goes to sample and hold, and then goes. What is the problem here? They may not correspond at the same time. This U velocity and V velocity may be slight time difference, could be a microsecond difference could be there. Suppose I want at the same time, exactly at the same time, the U value as well as V value, then you put two sample and holds here. That is what is seen in the next example. So U velocity sampled, it is held there. V velocity at the same time using a timer, simultaneously both are obtained, it is held in the sample. And this, now the two simultaneous samples are available. Doesn't matter now, once they are recorded, doesn't matter when you process them. Recording must be at the same time, so they have been recorded at the same time and held in the sample. Then after that, it is further processed, etc. So depending upon, you know, the need and how much money you can spend, it is possible to arrange circuitry in different form. Yeah, this is just telling about the A-to-D conversion. How it does the A-to-D conversion? The signal, analog signal comes, and it is almost like does like counting kind of thing. There will be a counter which will keep on increasing. Corresponding digital voltage will be generated. So that voltage will go here. It will compare these two, and when both of them become nearly equal within a certain this thing, then it says okay, now that we have generated the required digital signal, the process will stop and the digital will be processed. Otherwise, this will be increased from 0 to whatever value, up to this value of the old analog signal, it will keep producing a digital signal of equivalent value and they will be compared. So like that, and the number of digits available is what is 16 bit, 8 bit, etc. is here. So what is the least count of this will depend upon 1 divided by 2 power whatever. For its 8 bit means 1 by 256 will be the resolution, that is like 0.4%. In a 12 bit conversion, A-to-D conversion, 1 by 4096 is the resolution you get, that is 0.02%. If it is 16 bit conversion, 1 by 65536, that is 0.002%. So higher the number of bits of this A-to-D converter, that means higher resolution you have, your signal can be represented to within this kind of accuracy. Right? Please remember that eventually it is like a histogram. The actual signal will be like this, but you are representing the histogram, and how much error is there between the actual signal and the digitized one, that depends upon the number of bits of that A-to-D card. Higher the number of bits, better will be the resolution. And it basically does like our physical counting kind of process. Depending on the number of bits, it will keep on increasing the number and it will produce the corresponding digital voltage which is compared against the analog voltage. When they become essentially equal, then or just exceeded, it will immediately stop the process and that digital value will be taken as a correct value at that instant. These things happen at a very high speed, and they also, the clock speed will tell you how quickly it can generate the signal for comparison. Because you are comparing an instantaneous value. That instantaneous value, you must generate also the corresponding thing within that time. So if your clock speed of the A-to-D card is very high, let's say like 100 megahertz, which means whatever signal comes almost within not even microsecond, 1 by 100th of a microsecond, it can reach up to that similar value that is given here. So the higher the clock speed, the faster will be the response you will get, and correspondingly, you will be able to generate almost every signal within reasonable accuracy. Okay, I think this is about the A-to-D conversion and the data acquisition part. I think Sendhil will take over. And
so I am Sendhil. I am a research scholar doing my thesis work under Professor T. Sundarajan and Dr. V. Raghavan. I have been working in this hotwire for the past 4 years, and initially I had a lot of problems in the setup itself, like signal conditioning and things, and sir was there to clear for me all the time. But even after that, we faced a lot of problems, and now we know what is actually happening, how to process the signal, how to adjust the signal conditioning, how to obtain spectrum, all these details. Now we are very confident about getting it, and most of our results which we have yet to publish are they have a very good agreement with whatever is already been published. So I have put these slides to know, because people come to me and ask, I want to use your hotwire setup, tell me, can I use it? So for that reason, I have put this particular slide. There are several types of probes, and all the probes cannot be used for all the conditions. For instance, this is a unidirectional probe where only one directional flow, it's a 1D measurement probe. So you have, if you have your medium as gas or liquid, there are specific probes which can handle handle this. For instance, for a gas probe, you have a single sensor wire. This is tungsten and platinum coated, and you have film, fiber film probe. This fiber film probe is actually used for compressible flows, for high velocity air flows. It's actually made of quartz. The wire is actually made of quartz, and it has a little bit higher diameter so that it can withstand very high velocity. For liquid, you have the same. You have the same sort of probes. You can use the same single wire probe as well as the fiber film probe, but the coating, the amount of coating that is done on the wire will differ. For instance, for a liquid, they give something like 20. The Dantec gives us something like 20 micron wire, 20 micron coating. In liquid, there are several types like flush mounted. The flush mounted is like if you want to measure the wall shear stress for a liquid or a gas, you have this flush mount. What you do is mount it flush with the wall. So there is a film here, a thin film here, which will actually capture the velocity data. It's all one directional data. Similarly, we have a heavy coated fiber film, which I was talking. It's about something like 2 micron coating. For liquids, you use 2 micron coating. For air, you use 0.5 micron. So this is a bidirectional probe. It's a 1D probe, but bidirectional. See, the main problem with a single wire probe is that not only single wire, even the cross wire, it can't measure the reverse flow. It can measure the direction of the velocity in only one direction. If you want to measure the reverse flow, either you have to use something called as a flying hot wire anemometry, or you can use the Dantec has provided us with this probe. This is a very recent one. It's called as a bidirectional probe. The bidirectional probe in a it's a quartz tube here. The quartz tube is actually surrounded by two thin films. So thin film sensors. So this is film sensor 1 and sensor 2. So this is the flow direction. So what happens is when the flow comes and hits the sensor, a part of the flow goes here and the part of the flow comes the other way around. Suppose there is a reverse flow, the sensor 1 would predict different voltage from sensor 2. So meaning that there is some difference in the velocity across the two sides. So based on that, we should calibrate it for the flow direction as well as the reverse direction. We can get the direction of the velocity, whether it is going along the direction or in the direction opposite to the flow direction. Then we go for the two dimensional flow. If you want two dimensional velocity, the U component and the V component, the streamwise component and the lateral component, you have different flows like dual sensors. There also you have the fiber film. So the meaning, the main importance of going to fiber film is that it can be used for very high speed flows, as well as if it is coated with a very heavy coating, it can be used for even liquid flow measurements. Then we have a three dimensional flow, all the three. So this is a recent one which Dantec has manufactured. It's a gold plated one. All the three wires are placed such that they are mutually perpendicular to each other and capable of capturing all the three D velocities. And even some people in hydro turbo machinery lab, even with a single wire probe like 45 degree angle probe, if you are calibrating, if you use a specific techniques, you will be able to capture all the three dimensional velocity. But the problem is, you have to even during the measurements, you have to pitch and yaw the probe at different angles so that you can acquire the velocity. It's very very cumbersome and it's very tiresome work. So generally, people, if they want 3D, it is better to go to a three dimensional probe, which is shown. These are some miscellaneous probes. For instance, if you want to capture transition and separation in a plate, then we have this something called gluon probe. In a gluon probe, what we do is, you have a gold plated lid here. It is actually embedded inside a capton. Capton is a material. It's a synthetic material. It's very soft, and it's like 50 micron. The total dimension is around 50 micron, 50 micron thick, and the length and width can be based on your whatever dimension you need. You can ask the manufacturer, he might. The other one is, if you want to measure the hot wire data are very very sensitive to the ambient temperature. So if suppose your flow, you think that the temperature is varying between 2 to 3 degree centigrade, no problem. The inaccuracy incurred in 2 to 3 degree centigrade is about 0.2%, that's very small. But the moment it goes to something like 10 or 15 degree centigrade, you have a temperature compensated probe where you have a separate device which would measure the temperature at that particular near to that location, and it would compensate the resulting data from the hot wire. It will normalize and give you the original value. So we will talk about this, how to compensate your readings for temperature, because if suppose your temperature flow temperature is changing, what should be done? That will also be covered. So this is an important chart. We will be giving you the CD, it will be there. So this is these are the criteria where see medium, state of medium, flow condition, space condition, quantity to be measured. These are the conditions which you would be having. Based on this, you have to choose what type of probe you are using. All these probes will go with Streamline Pro as well as Mini CTA. Any setup you have, I am talking about the Dantec. Okay. So I don't know, PsiCorp is also manufacturing probes and hot wire setup, but I don't know about Psi Corporation. I've been working with Dantec Corp for a long time. So if you are going for a Dantec Corp, these are the different probes they recommend you for different applications. The next thing, once the probe is set, we have to check whether your probe is capable of responding to whatever frequency change, whatever signal change you have. Because a probe is of finite dimension. Suppose there is a change in the temperature, or if there is a change in the velocity of the flow, the probe must take in the response very quickly, and it should be capable of sending it to the feedback loop. So there is a time for its response. So they call it as the frequency response of the hot wire. Usually this is a standard procedure that everyone does, and this procedure you can do it in a Streamline Pro but not in a Mini CTA. What it does is actually it is connected to a square wave generator, which is connected parallel to the original Wheatstone bridge circuit which sir would have discussed. So what it does is it injects a square wave current, a current which is of square wave, a sudden current which is suddenly given to the, see it's like this. Suppose you have a flow and the flow is at very high velocity. So when it is going for a very high velocity, the loss of heat from the wire increases. So what happens to the current? The current in the wire increases. The resistance is adjusted such that the current in the wire increases, so that the wire gets heated up and maintains its temperature as 242 degree centigrade or set temperature. So when the flow is suddenly increasing, the temperature increases. The moment flows suddenly stops, suddenly goes to a smaller value, say the velocity decreases suddenly, then what happens? The probe has to sense the decrease in the temperature. The first here, if you measure the output voltage during the square wave test, this initial rise in the voltage is due to the square wave. The square wave gives a signal, a high current to the probe. So when it goes to the high current, immediately what happens? The circuit senses that there is some high current in the flow. So what it does? It counterinteracts the high current by reducing the current. By reducing the current and maintaining the wire temperature at 250. So this is the response which is taken up by the probe. So that you could see that the current voltage is reducing and it is acquiring the original 242 degree centigrade. So now this total height is designated as the total response time, but generally they don't consider the whole height. Instead, what they do is like a thermocouple, what we do is we have something called e power minus t by tau as our tau is the time constant. So we acquire that t by just equating the temperature to whatever time tau, that is time constant equal to temperature. That will happen when e power minus 1, when it happens e power minus 1, that value generally is taken as 0.632, and it is that value is taken to be the response time of the total response time. What is the time required? This is the total time. The time required for the voltage to drop from its maximum to 63.2% of its maximum. This particular time, the small time that is taken by the probe to sense that there is some increase in the voltage in the system is actually used for estimating what is called as the cutoff frequency. The cutoff frequency generally they give it as 1 by 1.3 times this value. So, if you want to find out a cutoff frequency for a particular probe, first what we have to do is we have to do this square wave test. You do a square wave test, once you do a square wave test, you would get this curve, how the voltage, output voltage is changing with respect to time. From the output voltage, we can find out this particular time, tau cu, that is the cutoff time. From this cutoff time, then you divide 1 divided by 1.3 times, the 1.3 times is a constant, multiplied by tau cu will give you the total cutoff time, which above which if you go, you will not be able to measure any frequency above this cutoff frequency. So, they generally use this curve to say the response time. You could see that is there is something like minus 3 dB cutoff, minus 3 dB comes here somewhere. So, the total frequency that you can measure with this particular probe will be nothing but 10 power 3, 10 power 2. So, it is cutting off somewhere here. So, it is around 10,000 hertz. So, this this curve is varied based on the velocity. So, from it has varied from something like 5 meter to 100 meter per second. So, the flow velocity is varying from 5 to 100 meter per second, and you could see that the flow velocity is increasing, the cutoff range is also increasing. So, if you want to operate, if you want to capture something like 10 power 4 hertz frequency in a turbulent flow, then it is okay. But if you want to capture more than 10 power 4, say 10 power 6 or so, those conditions, you cannot actually use the hot wire. But usually experience says that for a low Reynolds number flow, the amount of cutoff frequency is around 2500 hertz. For a very high velocity, for instance, if you go for something like 50 meter per second, it is sufficient to have something like 20 kilohertz. The 20 kilohertz maximum cutoff is sufficient. Now, Streamline Pro is giving us something like 400 kilohertz, which is far beyond that. We are not going to use such a high frequency cutoff anywhere. So, 400 kilohertz means you can go up to 200 kilohertz according to Nyquist criteria. So, anyway, 200 kilohertz is not possible, at least in the range considered like 0 to 50 meter per second. So, I think 400 kilohertz is more than sufficient. So, then you go for the sampling criteria. There are different criteria for selecting sampling, so number of samples required. For instance, what I did was I estimated the integral time scale or the integral length scale. I varied the samples by fixing the frequency. So, when I varied the samples from something like 1000 to 10 power 6, what happens is when you vary the sample after particular value of sample, the integral scale and the length scale becomes independent of the sample size. So, when you are going to find out what is the, when once the this 20 kilohertz, the frequency is set by the manufacturer, I said you. So, you can set as much high. If it is 400 kilohertz, you can use 400 kilohertz, it is not a problem. But once you fix this frequency, you have to know how many number of samples are required to be taken. So, whether the recording time has to, because this number of samples and the frequency will decide what is your total recording time. So, in my case where the jet flow, in a jet flow, it was found that after something like 1 lakh sample size, the integral time scale and the integral time and the length scale did not change. So, this is one of the method by which you can find out the number of samples. So, next thing is after acquiring data, these things you have to do digitally. When the digital data, you have acquired the digital data, you have to correct it for the temperature. The temperature correction correlation is just like this. It is the corrected voltage will be nothing but the TW minus T naught, where TW is the wire temperature minus T naught is the ambient temperature and initial ambient temperature, and TA is the ambient temperature at the present during the experimentation. Yes. Why do we do this? Because there is something called overheat ratio, which sir would have discussed. for the overheat resistance ratio, it would be estimated at a particular ambient temperature and a particular wire temperature. So when you operate such, when you fix the resistance based on the overheat ratio, you have fixed the temperatures, the set temperature and the wire temperature. The moment you put that particular probe in some other environment where the temperature is changing, then obviously the resulting voltage and the voltage which you obtain would be different from what it has been. It's like you have done a calibration at particular temperature and you are doing experiment at some other temperature, then you have some problem with the correlations. So what we do is we correct the we normalize, in sense we normalize or correct the original voltage, whatever voltage we obtain based on the current experimentation temperature. So this is a 1D probe where you have the airflow and you have one wire, and this is will be the wire axis, and you have to keep the wire such that the flow direction is always perpendicular to the axis of the wire. This is the axis of the wire and this is the axis of the probe. So place 1D probe such that the airflow is exactly perpendicular to the axis of the wire. So the next one is correction for zero temperature. See, for instance, in hot wire, if you see, you obviously when time goes on, the wire get wears and the physical properties of the wire changes. When the physical properties of the wire changes, obviously what will happen is when you have no flow, when you measure, when you start, when you bought a wire as a new one, you would have some voltage with at zero velocity. But the moment the time goes on, because of the wear and oxidization, what would happen is the temperature would, the initial temperature at zero velocity would be different. So we do some normalization for that also. So whenever you calibrate it, you don't consider the direct voltage as your criteria, but what you do is you take that voltage, the corrected voltage after temperature correction, and subtract it with the initial voltage, the voltage at zero velocity, the voltage measured when there is no flow. So typically when you do that, initially when professor would have shown, you would see this curve would have shifted but by some distance here, where the E naught will be there, E naught plus E square. Now since I have normalized, I would have a curve like this, which is starting from 0, and this is velocity, and this is basically the relationship between the transfer function or the relationship between the voltage squared and the velocity. So there are different methods, as sir would have discussed, to correlate the voltage to the velocity. For instance, you have King's law, and this is something called as a modified King's law, where you have one term which is 1 by n, the other term is 1 by 2. This particular term comes into play when you think that your probe is actually put in a place where there will be some small, very low velocities, like say 0.5 meter per second or 0.5 meter per second or 1 meter, within 1 meter per second. If there are small velocities, if you think that there will be small velocities incurred during your measurements, then that particular term will be taken care of, this particular part, and the other will be taking care of the high velocity part. Generally, what I observed is this King's law or modified King's law doesn't work most of the time, because we have a very powerful regression curve. So the entire data, if you are taking something like 30 velocity or 40 velocity, just fit with a piecewise polynomial. For instance, from 0 to 2 meters per second, you will have one polynomial. So 2 to 5 meter per second, you will have one more polynomial. 5 to say 20 meter per second, you will have one more polynomial. So you have to have a piecewise polynomial. Piecewise polynomial works very well, and the percentage error incurred with a piecewise polynomial is just 0.01%, while that of the King's law, I observed it is 0.1%. So next is the, after doing the square test and fixing the sample frequency, the time, all these things, we go for something called as the calibration. For a one dimensional calibration, you need not have any special instruments like yaw manipulator or the pitch manipulator, all these things. But for a two dimensional, you need something called yaw manipulator. The main problem with the Dantec system is that the yaw manipulator or the pitch manipulator is connected to a very dedicated calibrator system. The moment you put the probe inside, it would calibrate and give it to you. But when you are doing measurements, what you are going to do is you have to remove the probe and fix it in a separate traverse system. The moment you remove the probe from the calibration unit and put it in a traverse system, every condition is going to change, because you have calibrated at one particular condition, flow condition, and one particular angle, because two directional probes or two sensor probes are very sensitive to the direction. You should place exactly in the position what you placed in the calibrator, the same position you have to keep it. You cannot maintain that actually. It is very difficult for you to place the original position what was there in the during the calibration. And so what we did is, we have a manipulator fixed to a traverse system directly. This manipulator, what it can do, we can pitch it, yaw it, and even roll it by keeping it in, this is a wind tunnel, it's a vertical wind tunnel. You can pitch it, yaw it, roll it, as well as the same wind tunnel can be used for measuring also. The radial and the axial measurements also can be done with the same manipulator. So I think one wire calibration is very simple, but two wire calibration is not simple, because we get a net velocity. The total velocity is the voltage corresponding to the total velocity there. So we have to decompose that total velocity into U component and the V component. So there are something called effective sensitive calibration techniques. They take sensitivity and some coefficient, that is the probe coefficients into, because Dantec does that. What we saw, that even that did not work for most of the time, because the wire gets old. When we use the wire more than something like 50 times, obviously the wire physical property changes. So these K coefficient which is given by the Dantec is actually dependent on the wire physical properties. So we can in fact measure the wire physical property as well as the effective angle, which we are not going to discuss here, but it is a little bit cumbersome. So what we did is, we used something called as a tabulation method. So what we do generally is, when you acquire a voltage, the voltage will be actually directly mapped to U and V component. So when you have the voltage, you have a big data sheet where you will have these voltages. You take the voltage, you see where the voltages occurs, the mapping between these two voltages and the corresponding U and V can be obtained. This is the procedure which we are following. It does not require any property from the probe itself. So I will just discuss about this. The main problem with this particular procedure is that you have to pitch it, you have to yaw it some minus 45 degree to plus 45 degree. So you have to have a dedicated yaw manipulator, so you can place the probe at different angles, like minus 45, minus 35, minus 30, and different angles. So different angles at the interval, I have done it at the interval of 5 degree, and for each angle I have to vary the velocity from 0.09 meter per second and to 3.202 meter per second. So I use a mass flow controller to vary the velocities. So totally you would have something like 37 into 17 pairs of voltages for unique velocity. So you will have voltages and the corresponding velocity and the angle measurements. So it's like this. For particular angle of alpha equal to 45 degree, I will have say 37 velocities. When I have 37 velocity, I will have E1, E2, or the corresponding voltage from wire 1 and the wire 2. So you will have something like 19 alpha angles, which I've yawed at different angles of the hot wire, and I have acquired 19 values of alpha and 37. So this will have the total matrix. Now for the tabulation techniques, what I would do is, first I would find out what is E2. The E2 is known, but what I will do is, I will write E2 in terms of E1 with alpha equal to constant and Q in terms of E1 with alpha, meaning that for this alpha 1, I will try to fit a fourth order polynomial between this two and Q and E2. So now for each value of alpha equal to constant, I would have something like 19 into 2 values of correlation coefficients. Next, what I would do is, now since I know E1 as a function of E2, now I will fix E1 and find out what is the value of E2 and Q for different alphas. That can be done here. Take the value of E1, vary E1 from something like 0.03 volt to 1.3, it is not 0.03 volt, it is a normalized form, 0.03, it is old squared actually. So 0.03, and vary from 0.03 to 1.3. Substitute here 0.03 here, you will get corresponding E2 and the corresponding alpha value, you know that alpha value. So you will have this particular table generated. So once this table is generated, this table will have alpha E1, and now you can, what you can do is you can fix a fourth order polynomial between E2 and alpha and E2 and Q. So these two fourth order polynomial is fixed. Once this is done, the final step is just, if you have you need E1, E2 in terms of Q and alpha. What is Q? Q is the net velocity, alpha is the angle. Q cos alpha will give you U component, Q sin alpha will give you the V component. So once you know Q and alpha, you can find out what is U and what is V. So now E2, E1, how I acquired, I substituted here different values of E1, I can get Q. If I substitute different values of E2, I can get alpha, keeping E1 constant. So with these two polynomial fittings, these three polynomial fitting, now I will be able to generate E1, E2. See, you can see that E1 is 0.03 second and E2 is varying from 0.03 to second. Suppose you get a voltage of 0.3. Voltage from wire 1 is 0.03 volt square and voltage from wire 2 is 0.0, the normalized voltage 0.0. So now what you can do, you can go here, search in the table where this occurs, say 0.03, 0.03. So the corresponding Q and alpha can be taken, you can evaluate what is U component and the V component. This is the most simplest method, but it is more time consuming as well as it occupies more space, because you have to store this particular table, which is a very huge table which will be around something like 1 GB or 2 GB for a very, very large table. So in between values, we have only finite values here. The in between values, we use an interpolation technique to find out what is the corresponding velocities. So I said you can be obtained from Q cos alpha and Q. So this doesn't involve any effective angle correlations or the property calculation. It's independent of the probe, and you should make sure that the probe should be placed in the same position, same angle, and in the same ambience of that of the calibration. Then this works very well. But if you calibrate it in a particular system, some other system, and put it in a traverse, if the orientation change, this doesn't work. Yes, sir. Yeah, it's like a thermodynamic table. Yes. So how they are related, you have to do it using a polynomial fit instead of a correlation like King's law or the modified King's law. We use a polynomial fit because it's easy for us. You can split the whole range into several ranges and do it. Yet. Else. Two wires. It depends upon what measurements, where you are measuring also. So for instance, even in the central line you can get the mean velocity, but if you go far field there will be lateral components also come into, the V components also will come into play, and if you want to measure properties like isotropy and homogeneity, you need two component wires. If you want only the mean component and the what is the fluctuations along the mean direction, single wire is okay. One wire is okay, but because in a jet, for instance, if you take, when you go far field, there is lateral component also coming into play. Up to 4D or 5D, no problem. There is no V component. V component will be generally very small, something like 10 power minus 5 or 10 power minus 6. Very tedious. It may take 1 week for me, so I have to measure the temperature data also because for the temperature correction. But it's very tedious. But what I would do is, since everything is taken into account, for one month, I usually does 15 days once, because it takes one week for me to calibrate it. But then later I found that even for 2 months, where the ambient temperature is not changing much, say if it is changing only 2 to 3 degrees centigrade, the method is very awesome and it gives us a very accurate result. The thing is, I always check it with a single wire. If I have a U component, I find out the V component by changing the direction of the single wire and find out what is the V component, because U component almost all the curves will give more accurate value. But V component, there is always a problem. It should show zero velocity or very small velocity near the potential core of the jet. That is the conformation test. If it shows some velocity, there is a problem with the jet, or it could be the result of wrong calibration. So we confirm that the V component velocity by that method. So sir has already discussed about the autocorrelation function. So the autocorrelation function would be used for estimating the large scale length of the large scale structure. So I will not be discussing. So this is the autocorrelation curve that is obtained. See, the thing is, we did not use two wire here. We used a single wire to estimate the autocorrelation function. You can use two wire, as sir said. When there is two wire, you can vary the distance between the two wire and you can do. But the problem is, when you go very close to the wire, there is some distance you have to stop the stop it, because you cannot go too much close to the wire, because there will have an effect of heating of one wire on the other wire. There may be some interference effect, so we cannot go. But we have something called Taylor's hypothesis. I think they just assume Taylor's hypothesis, but my personal view is whether that is valid or not. Even I tried, but I don't know. So there you have the transformation function between the spatial coordinate to the temporal coordinate, so, or the temporal coordinate to the spatial coordinate. So what I do is, I use the temporal data, the time varying data, I just change it to the spatial coordinate using the transformation, the Taylor's, using Taylor's hypothesis, that is the force and flow approach, and I acquired this. Even here also you could see that from 1, you have directly, it is not starting from 1, instead it is starting from nearly, it is starting from 1, but it is very, very, very close, it just comes down. So because of the finite size of the wire length, that is why this problem is happening. And next is the Taylor's microscale. We call it as a Taylor's microscale. Taylor's microscale, we can estimate it from the autocorrelation function. This is the curve. This is the curve. In this curve, what you do is you fix something called as an oscillating parabola, which is done here. You could see a parabola. When the parabola goes and hits x-axis, the time axis, that distance will be taken as the Taylor's time scale, and from the time scale you can estimate what is actually the when you multiply with the corresponding velocities. Okay, so you could get what is the divide by the when you take the velocity and divide by the Taylor's time scale, you can get what is called as the Taylor's microscale. These Taylor's microscales are very important in combustion experiments. So combustion, it's like an average time scale. Neither the integral scales are the largest scale, the Kolmogorov scale or the smaller scale. So this lambda is somewhere in between these two. So generally for combustion experiments, we use this Taylor's macroscale or the macroscale or the microscales. What we do is this is what we can relate the Taylor's microscale microscale using the fluctuations and the gradient. Here you have the gradient here, del u dash by del z, what I was talking about, the Taylor's frozen and flow approach or the Taylor's hypothesis. When you use the Taylor's hypothesis, we can just transform the spatial coordinate into a temporal coordinate. So you have the velocity multiplied by the time, which will give you the spatial coordinate. So this particular term will be is very easy to calculate, because you have this term. What you obtain is the velocity as a function of time. When you have velocity as a function of time, you can use a central differencing or a higher order scheme to estimate what is the gradient of that particular fluctuations with respect to time. When you take that, take the average, the RMS value of that term, multiplied by this, these are the correction terms. Generally they use 1 by u square, but later they found that this may have some problems. Even the fluctuating components also plays a major role in the transport processes. So not in the transport process, in the transformation process between the Taylor's microscale and the correction was less, the variation, the deviation was less when you consider the velocity fluctuations also into the play. So this term would give you lambda directly instead of going to the main problem. Why I don't use this, because I said you already, it is there, the you should have zero difference when you the probes must be placed so close to each other, so that you can get it is like same point and you gradually increase the probe distance. But because of the finite size of the probe, you cannot go too much close and the interference effect. So this method, when we tried, it not work. It gave us some other values. And in fact, when we use this method, what we saw is that the Taylor's microscale was actually decreasing with respect to space in a jet. But that doesn't happen under a special condition. But in our jet, it was normal axisymmetric jet. So now again an assumption, assuming isotropy, you can find the dissipation rate epsilon, which is given by 15 nu u dash squared into lambda squared. This you know from the previous session. So you can find out the rate of the dissipation in any flow, and you can find out the smaller scale, the Kolmogorov scale. One epsilon is known. You can find out what is the Kolmogorov scale also.
Yeah, I mean, many of you might have done also some modeling with turbulence. So you have this turbulent kinetic energy K, which is, let's say, u prime square v prime square w prime square by 2, right? So this turbulent kinetic energy, we talked about the spectrum where this 5/3 slope is there. So at the end of it, where the dissipation starts, that's where the Kolmogorov scale will come into picture. So that in fact, he talked that as eta. Eta is the Kolmogorov scale. So the rate at which kinetic energy is dissipated, epsilon, is the rate of dissipation of kinetic energy at the Kolmogorov scale. And from theory, this is related to the kinematic. In fact, it happens at the viscous length scales. That is, viscosity also operates over very small length scales only. So the kinematic viscosity times du prime dz square, etc. That is a gradient, spatial gradient of the velocity fluctuation square multiplied by, in fact, you can see dimensionally. This has dimension of, for example, K is like kinetic energy. So it will be like meter square per second square. That is the dimension of K. Epsilon will have meter square per second cube. Because one more time comes in, so it will be meter square per second cube. You can verify here that that's a dimension. Kinematic viscosity has dimensions of meter square per second. And this will have per second square. Right? So it is meter square per second cube. So same thing as this. Now he told you how to convert the spatial gradient into a temporal one, right? Something like delta z can be taken as velocity times delta t kind of thing. But that velocity is not only the main direction, mean velocity, plus also the fluctuations, u prime, v prime, w prime, etc. Taken, all of them taken into account, you get the velocity. That velocity times delta t will give you delta z. So he replaced that using the so-called Taylor series hypothesis to get that. So first, he estimated the rate of dissipation, right, epsilon. And once epsilon is estimated, then from that, it is possible to get the Kolmogorov scale using one more relationship between them, right? Because dissipation also happens in the small, I told you that in the sub-range, without much dissipation, energy is transmitted. But at the Kolmogorov scale, it becomes thermal. Whatever is the kinetic energy of the eddies becomes dissipated as thermal one. So the dissipation rate, which is dk by dt, it can be related to the spatial gradient of the velocity fluctuation into the kinematic viscosity. He converted the spatial gradient into temporal one using the Taylor's hypothesis, etc. That's one way of doing. Another way of doing, if I estimate this L0, which is the integral scale. So integral scale and Kolmogorov scale are related, using the Reynolds number. So that he said this L0, other way, eta by L0, this ratio is re power minus 3/4 This is based on integral scale, no? This is based on, so you call it as L, capital L in terms of this. So there is a relationship between in these. So if you know the integral scale that you get from autocorrelation, then directly you can go to the Kolmogorov scale. So this is to understand across the spectrum, what is the size of eddies here, what is the size of eddies. See, although there is a universality about turbulent flow in general, but every particular problem has got its own integral scale, its own, if you are thinking of atmospheric turbulence, you may be talking about eddies which are like several meters long. If you are doing experiment in a wind tunnel, probably you are talking about largest eddy of few millimeter size. Alright, so it depends upon the problem, but still the scaling will be there. If your integral scale is centimeters, so Kolmogorov scale, what is there, no, like that, they are related. So how to get them? So the one way is to find the kinetic energy, then dissipation, rate of dissipation, from that using the gradient, spatial gradient of the velocity fluctuation, how to find the, once you find epsilon, then you can find eta from that, that is one way. Another way is to directly use the scaling and do that. So he described two methods of doing that. I thought since you missed out this k, etc., there may be some, you know, gap in the other thing. I thought this may be an appropriate point to point it out. Okay, thank you. No. Mean plus, see, eddies are being convected with the flow, right? So the mean will come, but simply using mean alone is not enough. You must use the total. It is like net effective velocity. You can call it somewhat like u plus. In fact, you can look at it in terms of velocity square only will come. So the u square, see, it will be like u square delta t square, right? This u square is substituted by u bar square plus u prime square plus v prime square, etc. These are all, these are like RMS, right? Plus this together. So that's one way of doing it. One method of finding, see, once you have got a whole set of data, from that how do you extract other details? So basically across the spectrum, how do you get this limit, how do you get this limit? All right. Between this limit to this limit, you have that minus 5/3 slope, etc. And then also what is the contribution of each of, you know, of course detailed spectral data is also possible that he is going to talk about in terms of fast Fourier transform, etc. But even the limits of one end integral to Kolmogorov, so the conversion, I thought a few gaps in there, we will understand. Yeah.